was in charge of policing in Brixton when we introduced the scheme to not arrest me for possession of cannabis, but the rest is history. And that's where I met Andrea. And Andrea and I have been good friends ever since. And Andrea asked if this meeting could be held here in the House of Lords today. You're actually in the House of Lords rather than the House of Commons, and you know that because everything is red. In the House of Commons, everything is green. My job is simply, because I'm hosting, I have to be present. I will say a few things after the other speakers have spoken. But in the meantime, I'll hand over to Frances Seeley, who is your chair for this evening.
Hi, welcome everyone. For those who don't know me, I know many of you do, I'm Frances Seeley from GlobalNet 21. And we set up some time ago to try and get people together to discuss the big issues of the 21st century. And we've grown rapidly over the few years that we've been going, and we hold about 75 events a year now on different topics. We've got a meeting in the House of Commons next week on women in the 21st century, the mayoral candidates and assembly candidates. Had a meeting a couple of weeks ago on life of crime and gang culture. So we do a tremendous number of meetings, and we have a wide audience. So we've got a wide audience here tonight. I'd like to welcome you all. A lot of GlobalNet 21 people from LondonNet, people from the London Debate Network, people from Facebook group as well, and also some of the people from Andrea's network.
I've seen you before.
Yeah, and the John Mordaunt Trust, which Andrea's involved in and started. And we're doing that jointly with her, and we're doing some follow-up activities on this as well. We've got some of our colleagues as well from the press and the media, including some freelance people who work on Panorama. So we've got a really good audience. Anyhow, what we're going to do is we're going to ask the speakers to speak. They're going to all speak for about 7 minutes each. And then after that, as we always do, we open it up to you for comments and for questions. And the rule we always have is I never ask a person to make a second question or comment if there are people up with their hands up who haven't spoken at all the first time. But if they haven't, there's time for you to come back. So if you're going to ask a question, make a comment, think about it carefully. Anyhow, the first person that we're going to ask to speak is Lee. Now, Lee is one of the founding members of Positively Women. And I mean, she's been involved in the whole drug issue for a long time. And we're doing this meeting because we did a meeting before with Andrea. And the whole question of the decriminalisation of drugs, the whole question of crime and drugs, the whole question of victimising and criminalising people came up. And because there's going to be a conference in the United Nations in April, Andrea thought this was absolutely pertinent to talk about this question now before that conference. And Lee has had a lot of experience in the area of the drug culture and knows about it more than most. So Lee, over to you.
Thank you. Okay. I haven't done any public speaking for quite a while. I'm a textile artist these days, but I have my activist hat on today, so. Okay. In a few weeks' time, world leaders will be heading for the UN in New York, where the United Nations General Assembly will hold a special session on drugs policy. I love what Kofi Annan has to say about it upon the run-up to this UNGASS meeting. Drugs are dangerous, but current narcotics policies are an even bigger threat because punishment is given a greater priority than health and human rights. And it is now time for regulations that put lives and safety first. Globally, the war on drugs has not succeeded. 300 million people now use drugs worldwide. Prohibition has had little impact, with drug production just moving to another location, trafficking to another route, and drug users switching to another drug. Nor has prohibition reduced use. The widespread criminalisation and punishment of drug users, the overcrowded jails, means that the war on drugs is a war on drug users, which equals a war on people. Drugs have destroyed many lives, and drug government policies have destroyed many more. I was diagnosed in Holloway Prison nearly 30 years ago. I was an intravenous drug user, in fact, fixing straight into my jugular, and was in prison for the third time on yet another drug-related crime. I was offered no support for this or my addiction. In fact, I was segregated and my food was passed to me through the hatch. The stigma and prejudice I encountered there and upon my release spurred me on to become an activist, as I was so angry that HIV was not being treated in society like any other illness. The stigmatization and incarceration of drug users today is pretty similar. In what other areas of public health do we criminalise patients in need of help? I first started taking drugs in 1968. I certainly didn't know, and I don't think England knew much about addiction back then. I don't want to talk about me. Strict instructions from Andrea. Only want 7 minutes, and 63 years of my life would take a lot longer than that. But one good thing that came out of those dark years of the UK AIDS era was the start of proper needle exchanges in the UK. And harm reduction services that were already in place certainly helped me when I asked how long I had to live and was told by my specialist he didn't know, maybe 6 months or a year, but that I stood a better chance if I stopped taking street drugs. I was referred to my local DDU. I was given a methadone prescription. I sincerely believe that without that harm reduction approach, I wouldn't have survived my addiction. During that time, I didn't commit another crime. I put on weight, I went to my hospital appointments. Of course, I'd sometimes use on top of my script, especially my boyfriend's prescribed dimorphine. But the downside was I'd become a slave to the chemist. And of course, I was quite resigned to dying from AIDS. It was a very dark year. But 2 years later, I was still alive, and I made the decision to stop using drugs. And again, the drug dependency unit helped. I went to abstinence-based rehab for primary and secondary care. That was 27 years ago. Without that help, I doubt I would be sitting here today. The world doesn't need to reinvent the wheel. They just need to look at models that work. When Portugal in 2001, when 1% of the whole population was using heroin and the HIV infections were amongst the highest in the world, the decision they made to decriminalize possession and replace it with a health response wasn't because they had discovered a radically effective approach to treatment, it was because they saw the criminal justice-led response as both being ineffective and harmful. In adopting a health-based policy, they were using treatment approaches that had been used in the UK for more than 25 years. Methadone, rehabilitation, detox, care planning, social reintegration, where people still drop out of treatment, where people still re-engage later without the threat of criminal sanctions. It's a known fact now that drug-related deaths, HIV, Hep C diagnosis, and especially crime rates have been vastly reduced due to this change in the law. Whilst here, in the UK, it initially was a country with excellent approaches to tried and tested models of harm reduction, varied treatment options, and there are many, we now have the highest record of drug-related deaths ever recorded. Couple that with a statement issued just this month by the Association of Directors of Public Health about 2 million cuts in public health funds to local authorities. 78% of their directors say that drug and alcohol services are likely to be reduced, which will have a detrimental effect on health in their areas. Personally, I believe it's to be more than likely. Our prisons are overcrowded. Drug-related crime costs an estimated $13.5 billion in England and Wales. And whilst now there are great drug treatment programs, such as RAP working within the prison population, my worry is upon release is what kind of relevant support are they going to get in the current climate of major cuts in services. I thought I would just open the door on the substance misuse bill today through the heart and eyes of my sister. She works with vulnerable females who are sex working to fund their addiction. She says, we used to offer client focused service where we had time to work on individual care plans, encouraging and motivating towards change and safe practices. We now spend most of our time entering evidence of every conversation, advice, and decision made. The current process misses the point. We no longer make the difference we once did. We used to help people make better decisions, which kept them and the community safer. She concluded by saying she misses working in a caring profession, although she still does, and making a real difference. Over 25 years ago, when I first started working in the HIV field, both nationally and internationally, we had to pick and choose the funerals we went to. As we all know, the advances in medical science, things have changed here in the UK. But we have another major health epidemic. Over the last decade, deaths from hepatitis C-related end-stage liver disease and liver cancer has doubled. The majority infected or co-infected are people from the majority infected are co-infected are people from marginalised and underserved groups, such as car and drug shop users. Only 10% of people are accessing treatment, partly due to the government not prioritising and ring-fencing money for Hep C treatment, let alone the relevant support services that are badly needed. Whilst on a global scale, the UK's crystal meth scene is deemed by the Home Office as no big lie. Specialist clinics in London are saying they're overwhelmed with the numbers of methamphetamine users coming through their doors, and the rise of new HIV and Hep C diagnoses linked to this and other chemosex drugs, so alarmingly wide, especially in London. I was watching the news the other night. There was a woman openly talking to me about the fact she has to put everything on the line in order to obtain cannabis for medical pain. She had multiple cirrhosis. Her career, her family, her income were all being affected by having to find ways to score on the streets. Again, the UK is going against the grain when compared with other leading nations, such as Canada, the Netherlands, Israel, and over 20 states in the US. The logical first step is, in policy change would be to take cannabis out of Schedule 1 and place it into Schedule 2. Its status then would greatly facilitate research, thus stimulating UK medical research. Again, no need to reinvent the wheel, just look at the findings of research in other countries. The children of this country are using drugs at a younger age. As I said earlier, I started using at 15. I now live in Kensington and Chelsea, and kids as young as 10 are running the streets around that area in Holland Park for pocket money on their bicycles. My nephew lives in Surrey. He changed schools a couple of years ago because all the kids in his class, he was 14 at the time, were taking methadone. And you can picture the scene of poorer parts of the country where drugs and crime are rife, concerning future generations. Going back to Kofi Annan's words, we all want to protect our family from potential harm of drugs. If our children do develop a drug problem, surely we will want them to be cared for as patients in need of treatment and not branded as criminals.
Thanks, Lee. I mean, it was really important to have someone who's been through the experiences that you've been through talking, and it's been at the sharp end. I also noticed you were instructed by Andrew and you obeyed. I want you to know we've all been instructed by Andrea and we've all obeyed, so you're not there. Anyhow, next we've got Molly Meach here. Molly is a British peer and a former social worker, and she has chaired the UK Parliamentary Group on Drug Reform Policy, which recommended the decriminalisation of drugs. And she's going to talk a bit about the international aspect, I think, because you know, the UK is probably behind many other countries in having a very positive approach to the drug problem. Things are changing in Canada and Portugal and Ireland, but the UK has sort of got its head stuck in the sand. Molly's going to talk, I think, a bit about that.
Okay, right, well, thanks very much. This won't be anything like as interesting as what you've just heard, but the good news is I'm strictly limited to 7 minutes, so I haven't got to endure me for too long. As you've said, the UN meeting is occurring in the middle of April, and I and Mike and goodness how many other people will be there. And of course, the wonderful thing would be if we would have a change to the conventions, either at that meeting or sometime over the next 10 years. The bad news is, frankly, in my view, that simply isn't going to happen because Russia and China and God knows, you know, lots of other countries simply won't have it. But then the good news, as far as we're concerned, is that there are ways in which a member state that really wants to introduce a human rights and public health drugs policy can perfectly well do that. And we have four levers, four justifications that we are putting forward and will continue to be putting forward for member states to do that in the context of the UN conventions without breaching those conventions. Mike may say he disagrees with this, and there are certainly people who say, oh no, you can't really do that. Well, we had a legal opinion from Lord Carlisle, a very, very senior human rights lawyer in this country, and he's very clear that you can. Member states really can go pretty much all the way within a human rights and public health context. What I'm going to go on and say does not permit countries to, as it were, interpret the conventions in a way that is contrary to human rights and public health. Absolutely not. So we need to be very, very clear about that. So the first justification or lever that we put forward is that we need, and member states need, to use a new modern interpretation of the term scientific purposes. The 1961 Convention makes clear that the objective of the international narcotics system is to limit exclusively to medical and scientific purposes the trade in and use of controlled substances. Okay, that term, scientific purposes, has never been defined. And that's really very important. Today, the introduction of a policy and the scientific evaluation of that policy is regarded as a scientific purpose, perfectly legitimate scientific purpose. And Lord Carlisle, in his legal opinion on this, agrees with that view. He accepts that in the past, this hasn't been brought out by lawyers, and he argues that always lawyers take account of the political situation of the day. And the fact is, the political situation across certain parts of the world, not the whole world, unfortunately, has shifted, and we need to take advantage of that, those changes. Professor Peter Reuter, very senior, highly regarded academic in drug policy, regards this approach to the term scientific purposes not only as legitimate, but he said ingenious, actually. He said, why didn't I think of that one? anyway, I mean, he really is. I've always regarded him as extremely cautious, so it was quite something to have Peter to come on our side of things. And he identified eight different models of regulated markets in a recent paper. And at this stage, we've got several of those models being tried in Jamaica, in Uruguay, and as you know, various states in the US. The important point from our point of view, the fact is there is flexibility, there are changes. People are pushing the edges of the conventions, but in my view, remaining within the conventions, but with these new interpretations. The important thing is that these new regulated markets are evaluated. We don't want these things to happen and not to know whether this model or that model or the other one is most effective at reducing addiction, reducing violence, corruption, and all the other things. We actually want to know which ones work. So that's one justification for scientific purposes. The second is the supremacy of the human rights obligations over the drug conventions. And this is absolutely vital to the whole thing, everything that I'm going to say. The human rights obligations are a part of the UN Charter. Therefore, they're fundamental to the mission of the UN and its member states. The UN Charter explicitly states, and I'll quote it, in the event of a conflict between the obligations of the members of the UN under the present charter and their obligations under any other international agreement, their obligations under the present charter, i.e. human rights, prevail. Absolutely no question about that. So the sort of examples of drug policies that I believe should be challenged by a member state or by people within a member state on this grounds, you are breaching human rights here, and they are supreme, are, for example, aerial eradication of crops. Vulnerable people, they're having their livelihoods just ripped away from them. Secondly, the incarceration of drug mules or other vulnerable people caught up in the drugs trade who have little or no option actually to carry on with what they're doing. So within the UN Drug Conventions, the requirement to prohibit the trade or use, sorry, so that's the second justification, human rights, okay? The third one is the right of governments to determine their priorities within their limited resources. This relates to domestic policies, not to external policies. You know, regulated markets inevitably, I would have thought, will lead to some trade issues, and you may want to discuss those. But in terms of internal policy, within the UN Drug Convention's requirement to prohibit the trade or use of controlled drugs, there is a degree of autonomy for member states, if they want to use it, to decide how best to meet those requirements. This freedom is underpinned by the preamble to the Vienna Convention on the Principle of International Law. In particular, a member state has autonomy over its allocation of resources to finance domestic policies to meet the needs of their populations. The US has used this particular argument rather well, I think, and I bow down to Obama, because I think if Obama were not there, the Federal Ministry of Justice would have pounded in there and crushed these regulated markets. And this is why I am passionate about what I'm saying here tonight, because if we get Donald Trump or anyone like him, seriously, in the US, we will find the regulated markets will be crushed. Crushed. Unless there are people, the governors of those states, can stand up and say, this is perfectly legitimate within the human rights conventions, within the definition of scientific purposes, within. So it's very, very important, I think, in the context of the US, and actually then much more widely across the world. So very important is that the principle of self-determination of member states is also subject to the supremacy of the human rights obligations. I say that because when I go, I was in New York recently talking about all this stuff, and somebody said, yes, but then Russia can go and execute people and then evaluate it, and that's then fine. And I said, no, it's not, because they will be breaching the human rights of their human rights obligations. So these justifications for reform hang together, and the imperative is to observe human rights and public health, and not to go in the other direction. The fourth and last justification relates to Portugal and decriminalisation of possession and use. And this comes from the commentary to the 1988 convention, which says very clearly, it will be noted that as the 1961 and 71 conventions, paragraph 2 does not require drug consumption as such to be established as a punishable offence. So this commentary and other bits of the 1988 convention do actually support the decriminalisation of possession and use. Even so, as people here probably know, the International Narcotic Control Board tried very hard in the early days of the Portuguese policy to tell them that they were breaching the conventions. So this is what happens, and this is what we'll see happening again and again. When member states do push the boat out, interpret the conventions in a particular way, no doubt, unless we can reform the INCB, and my argument is we need to, if we don't, they will try and push back. And member states need the arguments to hang on to in order to pursue their reform policies. And that's why I believe all this is so very important. So my view is there is flexibility out there. There are all these experiments. We just need to make sure they're evaluated. And essentially, that's what a lot of this is about. And I do want to mention that we do have some fairly important supporters of this view, although there are people, and Mike may talk about them, people who just want to see reform of the conventions and see this all as a bit of an irrelevant sort of distraction. I passionately disagree with that view. And George Soros, who has put vast sums of money into drug policy reform, believes that this is the right way for the world to go. And he has convinced the Deputy Secretary General of the UN that this is the right way for the world to go. So they are quite useful allies. But there's a fierce argument going on out there, and no doubt it will continue to go on. And I have no doubt that it will take many, many years for the prohibitionist approach to drug policy to be overturned. It will take years in this country, I fear, and in many, many countries of the world. But at least now there are some arguments out there for people to use if they wish to use them. Thank you.
Okay, thanks, Molly. I mean, that gave a very good perspective on the international situation and what's possible and what the problems still are that we have to face. When Andrea arranged this, and she did a lot to arrange this, so we have a lot to thank Andrea for, she managed to get a very special guest for us who has come all the way from Colombia just for this meeting, to speak in 7 minutes, which is amazing.
Wow.
And she has a lot of experience, Maria, she has a lot of experience on the producer side of the drug problem. And she's going to tell us a little about that, perhaps probably more than a little. So Maria, over to you.
Thank you very much.
I had a paper and a serious presentation prepared, but I sort of, it got lost from Columbia to you. So I'm going to improvise, but like you said, I do know my issues.
You know your stuff.
Yeah, I know my issues. So I coordinate an organization called Mama Coca. Mama Coca works with coca growers' issues, and we were instrumental to stopping aerial spraying. I'm glad you mentioned it. It was a very important issue. It's the greatest human right, mass human rights violations as concerned drug prohibition. It's amazing. It went on for 35 years, informally for 5 years, and officially for 30 years. And surprisingly, we weren't able to stop it. We worked and worked on the Coca was founded in 1998. And since then, we've been working. We have a chronology. We have all the information. We carry out class action suits, I don't know what they're called here, and all sorts of legal measures to stop it. And finally, the OMS said that glyphosate, which is the latest chemical they were spraying with, was cancerous, so they decided to pick that up, and the Colombian government was able to stop. I think we were working on it because of great pesticide producers. It was a big business. Pesticides are an amazing business in Colombia, and we're still booked on them. So we're environmentally a very destructive situation. It's used for coca growing, intensive coca growing, and expands coca. And it was also until October 2015. So this I'm talking about just now, we managed to stop them. And so finally, okay, so that stopped thanks to the OMS and thanks to our health minister, who is a drug expert, okay? So the situation is that all of the countries in the world produce and consume something, some sort of substance that we now know as drugs. The difference is that they, much like they distinguish between licit and illicit drugs, there's a distinction between, a false and arbitrary distinction between producer countries and consumer countries, but we're all there. The issue is that in Colombia, we're known as cocaine producers, but our great tragedy as relates to drug conventions is growers' issues. These are, we're talking about farmers that have no land and they're very, very poor, so they produce coca. And they ended up producing coca, and this coca growing ended up making all the guerrilla. We have been in a civil strife, which is, the politicians refuse to call a civil war, but it is a civil war that has been raging since the 1960s. So we have the oldest guerrilla group in America, in Latin America. We have tons of armed forces. We have the FARC, so which we are now having peace talks with. We have the ELN, Ejército de Liberación Nacional. We have other smaller guerrilla groups. We have paramilitary groups, which were demobilized in 2006, formerly in 2006, and which have become what is known as criminal bands, LACRIM. These criminal bands, they're all now, including the armed forces, the police is militarized in Colombia because of the narcotics traffic. So everything in Colombia is tied to the narcotics traffic. The state is, not all of the institutions are corrupt, but believe me, Colombia is highly corrupt. I mean, it's maybe not as corrupt as Mexico, which is really known for its corruption, but it's very, very, there's a lot of corruption. And it's all tied to the narcotics traffic. So what I wanted to say is that, yes, there's producer countries and consumer countries, but our problem is growers. Growers are not necessarily producers, even though in the past few years they have become producers. So what do they produce? They produce a value-added product, which is called basuco. Basuco is not the same as crack, but it would be the equivalent as far as the use and the effects. It's a highly, I don't know if it's substances or addictive in themselves, or it's the people that become addictive because they have a propensity to become addictive, but it's highly addictive. It's not the same, it's not as pure as crack cocaine. Crack cocaine is when you take cocaine and you
reverse it and it becomes a pure substance, basulco, is a step from coca, from the coca leaf, to cocaine hydrochloride. So it's a dirt. It's the junk that comes when you prepare. And that's what people are smoking. And that is a big issue because a lot of the growers, as prohibition gets worse, a lot of the growers go to find the means to keep up with the fact that they're being persecuted, and they start preparing, processing this product. So there are regions of Colombia where poor farmers are processing this. And it's a drama because this is all driven by prohibition and by corruption, which allows for this, and lack of land reform, which makes peasants very poor, very poor. So they're tied to the land, okay? So Santos has decided he's going, there's a group of Latin American presidents, among which is Santos, which is pushing drug reform, which is great. I mean, it's fantastic. It makes a great difference in Colombia. Thing is, he's since the movement now is for cannabis, for marijuana, he's got into this. So this year you have a presidential regulatory decree which legalizes medical marijuana. There's also, the Congress is also pushing a law through for medical marijuana. But basically the only thing that is being reformed in Colombia is what is happening elsewhere, like basically in the United States, which is our, you know, under whose shadow Latin America operates. So that's the way it is. So they're legalizing medical, or it's legal, medical marijuana is basically now legally produced in Colombia. They're thinking of a big export business competing with the States. But our issue is coca. So there we're not getting anywhere. We're not getting anywhere because the world doesn't know that coca exists. I mean, you think about cocaine, but there's no relationship with coca. Coca is a plant. Coca is a medical substance. I mean, the Indians have been using coca for religious purposes. Am I going overboard with my time?
No.
Keep going.
Just inviting those people up a couple of seats here.
It is. Okay, well, just let me know.
Can
we shut them up?
Okay, so, there's no reform with coca. Coca is not cocaine. Coca is a very, very useful plant. It's part of the life cycle of the region, it's environmentally. So what we have tied to the drug issue in Colombia is a severe environmental devastation issue. Drug prohibition pushes growers all over the country, and this is like one of the most biodiverse countries in the world with tons of water and amphibians and everything, okay? So they push the drugs, and as they destroy the frontier, the environmental frontier, mining ventures come in, large landowners come in, they push the growers and they take over and they start with large land holdings. So land concentration in Colombia is severe. Now, the reason I'm mentioning this is because we're not working with coca, we're not addressing coca, and coca is essential to peace in Colombia. So what has to be addressed in Colombia is land reform, agrarian reform, land distribution, social justice, and not medical marijuana. Medical marijuana is fine, okay. You want a business, it's going into big business, the way it's being approached in Colombia. So right now there is a law that's called that was just passed by Congress, which is formed by landowners and paramilitary and people heavily tied to the narcotics traffic, because that's the way politics has made it in Colombia. They've made money, they got power, so they're in Congress. So there's a law that's being passed, it's called CIDRES. And it's rural development zones. But what they're doing is they're taking 7 million hectares during the big narcotics trade boom in Colombia. 7 million hectares were co-opted, were robbed, were exploited from peasants by the narcotics traffic. Now what the government is doing is taking another 7 million hectares of public land, of the nation's land, and giving it to private, international and national private investors, so they can hire peasants to work for them. So this is totally contrary to land reform. This is contrary to beans, and this is contrary to coca, to stopping coca expansion. So basically, the good side is there's drug reform. The bad side is, the downside is that the landed gentry or landed big landowners in Colombia are not ready to let go. So coca and cocaine will continue arriving as long as we do not stop this land concentration and demand land reform in Colombia. So that's where the issues lie in Colombia.
Okay.
If I wasn't clear, I could send you my.
That was fantastic. I always tend to be strict on time, but I just couldn't possibly stop someone who came all the way from Colombia to speak. That was really, really
good. It was clear, anyway.
And it was very clear, absolutely. So thank you. That was really enlightening. And yeah, we've got Mike now. Mike Trace. Mike is the CEO of the Rehabilitation for Addicted Prisoners Trust. He's also been Deputy UK Anti-Drug Coordinator in 1997-2001. And he's going to talk to us, I guess, about the United Nations conference on UNGASS, and he's also going to do a webinar with us later on to actually go through that in more detail, which he's going to do a few days before the conference in the United Nations itself. So, Mike, thank you for doing this, and over to you.
Thanks very much, Francis. Good evening, everyone. And the hat, I wear several hats, but the hat that you didn't mention is probably most appropriate for the senior chairman of a thing called the International Drug Policy Consortium, which is a big NGO network, World Church, that tries to influence what governments are doing around their UN debate. So that's a tough job. So I'm going to speak a bit, as Francis said, about this UN drug summit that's coming up. Molly's mentioned it before, I'll pick up on that. A bit about the process, what's happening there, and what's politically at stake, and how it's going so far, which is joy. And then I'll talk a little bit about the UK government role in that process and try and link it back to what the UK government's doing politically. But it's only 7 minutes, so it's going to be pretty broad brush, and obviously we've got Q&A later, we can pick something up. First of all, on the UN Drug Summit, has been mentioned a couple of times, the last one was 1998. I can see three of us in the room who were there. That's 18 years between drug summits. There's lots of activities in between time, but it's not a sign of urgency at the UN on this issue. The reason this summit has been called, the next formal review was meant to be in 2019, but three Latin American presidents 2 or 3 years ago said the situation is so pressing in our countries that the international community really has to look at this issue and think about different ways of handling it. And President Santos of Colombia was one of those leaders, and they went to Ban Ki-moon and said, we can't wait for 2019, and so we have a summit in 2016. I'm very pleased we are that we're having it. The timetable has been that ever since that was back end of 2012, early 2013, has been the preparations, and 3 years for preparations. Sounds a little sluggish, but in UN terms, that is fast. They've got to the point where they're running the summit, as Molly said, 19th to the 21st of April. The process is that it's a member state process. So 207, whatever it is, member states get to talk to each other and say, what do we want to do at this summit? But basically, they have to do two things. One is agree, 207 countries, on a declaration or a statement. So you can see how hard that's going to be. And second of all, they all get the chance to speak. So they send their heads of state, or if they don't want to send their heads of state, they're a bit embarrassed about it all, they send the minister or a sub-minister or an official representing the sub-minister or the person who cleans the toilets. It's up. They decide that pretty late on. And there are a lot of countries, first thing I want to say about this whole process, there's a lot of countries around the world who wish it would just go away. They're committed to existing strategies. They don't want to change anything. There was a great representative, I won't mention the country, but in one of the early negotiations, the representative of the this particular country, sat in the negotiations and said, the most important thing about this UN drug summit is nothing must happen. Yeah? And if I said to you that these summits and the preparations for them cost tens of millions of pounds to happen, that wasn't a rarity. There's a lot of people who stood up in these negotiations and said, the most important thing is nothing must change at this summit. So you can see what sort of barriers to change there are. So the consensus is going to be very difficult, and we're watching the negotiation of this consensus document, line by line, minute by minute, negotiation by negotiation, and it's painful. It really is painful. I don't suggest any of you spend too much time on it. You've got better things to do with your life. But basically, that consensus document is going to be important, where it ends up, and it will be presented at this summit in April. I'm getting more interested in what the political leaders are going to say. What level of person is sent, leader is sent by each country, and how strongly they say what they're free to say on behalf of their country. So for example, if Obama turns up and starts talking about redirection of drug policy, that is a game changer. Yeah? Everybody else follows that, and you don't care what the consensus document says. The US is standing up there and saying, all that millions of people in prison was a bit of a mistake, sorry about that, let's change. That is a historical redirection policy. I don't think he will. This is not something that it's in the interest of the US to be a leader on it right now in an election year, but you never know, we're working on that. So just be aware, we're talking about the outcome document, which is consensus, which is difficult, but any leader of any member state, including the UK, at ministerial level, whatever, can go and say great things at the summit, and that goes down in the record. And the symbolism is as important as the consensus document. Molly mentioned a couple of times that I was going to disagree with you. Now I'm not. I never disagree. I make it a policy not to disagree with you. Within that, there is a big tactical debate in the reform-minded organisations about should we be pushing for convention reform? Should we be pushing for the first step towards convention reform? Should we be emphasising the flexibility and the legal ability of governments and member states to work within the current system? I'm totally agnostic about that. That's a tactical argument, in my view. And there are good arguments on all sides on that. The important thing is, with this UNGASS and any reform of drug policy at UN or national level, is we clearly consign to history the repressive, militaristic, and punishment-based approaches that have dominated for 50 years, and we clearly move towards the health and human rights and social policy approaches that previous speakers have talked about. There's 100 tactical discussions about how to do that, or how fast to do that, or how to achieve that, but the speed with which we accelerate that change is how we should measure whether we've achieved reform or not. As I say, various fascinating debates about tactics, but that's what they are, tactical debates. Why I use the word acceleration is I've worked in the field 30 years, but I've been around this UN stuff about 20 years. And for a long time, any of us, Andrew included, who's been saying, well, actually, that punishment-based approach is that repression of populations, minorities, and poor people, and that use of drug control as an instrument of state control of minorities is wrong. Yeah, we've been saying that's wrong for a long time. You have no chance, and I've been in pretty senior jobs in national governments, international agencies, you have no chance of having that implemented for a long time, because the political power and diplomatic power that wanted to keep the current drug control system was pretty immovable. Last few years, it's movable. So our job is to move it as fast as possible. Not to implement reforms that may be worse than what happened before. You don't just throw stuff at a wall and hope it sticks, but to use this opportunity to accelerate the move away from punishment, repression, human rights abuses towards health, social care, humane policies. And that's happening. A lot of countries are doing some good stuff, and a lot of debate at UN is so much more open than it was when I worked there. So our job is to accelerate that in any way we can. The important thing that we want to see out of the UNGASS is that there is no consensus in the UNGASS. Don't let anybody kid you that governments actually are agreeing on anything in this UNGASS. There was a great thing, the guy who's in charge of the UN agency that oversees the drug control system is a Russian, and Russian drug policy is particularly punitive and repressive. But this guy's a good diplomat, and he's actually done, in many ways, a reasonable job in his UN role. He was asked, how can you say that the world has a consensus when one country deems as legal something else that another country applies the death penalty for? How is that a consensus? Big guy, is he bigger than me? He's a Russian guy, close to Putin, scary guy. He leaned forward, to the microphone and said, it's a very broad consensus. And that kind of sums it up. Nobody's even seriously, not even the guy in charge, is seriously trying to argue that the international community agree on this stuff. So you won't get a sensible consensus document. We'll all do our best job to try and make it the best document possible, but you won't get a sensible, coherent consensus coming out of the UN April 21st. What it is important to is governments go away from that meeting thinking, like Colombia, we want to experiment, we want to do new things, we want to depart from the previous traditions, and it's okay to do that. And to be honest, a lot of countries are already saying that. See your t-shirt, mate, Canada. Canada's already doing that, Uruguay's already done that, large parts of the US, large numbers of countries implementing consumption rules, they're already departing from that consensus. The really important symbolic measure is they come away from April saying, yeah, it's okay to do that. A lot of other countries say, what works for my population, I'm going to now do that. I'm not going to be kept in this straitjacket. And there's some signs that that's the feeling that's going to happen. But don't be under any illusions. There's a lot of countries who quite like repression. So they're not going to give that up easily. The UK government's role within that. The first thing to understand, I don't know if Brian, you're going to talk about domestic policy a bit more, but the thing about the UK government at the moment is it really, really doesn't want to talk about drug policy. And it certainly doesn't want to talk about drug policy reform. Now, these judgments are made, not anything to do with drug policy. They're made for strategic reasons of what the government narrative is, what issues it wants to deal with, and what it finds difficult. And to be honest, like most governments, it finds drug policy and drug policy reform a difficult issue. And it particularly finds that a difficult issue because the Prime Minister said some pretty reform-minded things 10 years ago about drug policy, but the
he
position...
said the legalization word.
Thank you, Andrew. is somebody who has a broad background and knowledge in this issue and is on record of saying some pretty reform-minded things. As Prime Minister, there is no way he can say those things again. So a judgment is made very early on this government and in coalition saying, this is a tricky one for us, we're not going to talk about it. The exception to talking about it is they've had to respond to the new psychoactive substances challenges. Now, I absolutely support the government. They cannot do nothing when there's a lot of new substances coming on the market, and there's a lot of new harms coming out of that. So they had to respond to that, not in favour of how they have responded to that, but obviously they had to deal with that legislatively, and they had to do something. So they've tried to bring in legislation around something that they felt needed legislation on. I think all parties broadly agreed something needed to be legislated on, and they've tried to do that without opening up discussion of the wider issues whatsoever. And we can have a debate in the Q&A about that act. I've got my own views on it, but basically they've had to do that, but they've done it as low-key as possible. And Brian and colleagues and Molly and colleagues in House of Lords have tried to get under the nub of what is the thinking behind this particular piece of legislation, and the Prime Minister is totally unwilling to talk about any of the background thinking. And I don't know if anybody even knows about it, but the National Drug Strategy is under review as we speak. And the new national drug strategy will be launched by the end of March. Now, I'm guessing, even you guys, I'm assuming you're interested in this subject, I'm guessing none of you have been invited to express your views to government or get involved in that review. They're doing it as low under the radar as possible. I'm told that I'm not even allowed to refer to it as a consultation, because consultation has statutory limits and statutory processes. It is a review. It's a review of the drug strategy. And they're really, really keen. And some of these people are guys I like, guys and officials in the departments. They just want to put out a bland document again at the end of March that says as little as possible, addresses none of the big issues, I think, facing us all. So all of these things are happening because the government really doesn't want to talk about drugs. So what that means is our representatives in Vienna are doing a reasonably worthy job, a couple of good things, a couple of less good things. But the UK, which we remember 10 years ago, was and by us, I was one of them, was going out to Vienna regularly and saying we need a more less punitive approach, a more health-based approach. The UK is pretty silent on all that stuff at the moment, and certainly is trying to tamp down any discussions of reform. So the UK is not a reformer, not really wants to, doesn't really want to talk about that, and it's all happening under the radar. This is diplomatic things that is not discussed at all in public or parliament.
Okay. Right, thanks. That was a good description of what is possible and what is impossible internationally, and also you've got an accent like mine, so it makes you a quite a bit anyhow, we've got Brian now. Brian Haddock is kindly agreed to host this meeting, and Brian, as many of you I'm sure know, was the Deputy Assistant Commissioner in the London Met. He's also a Liberal Democratic candidate for the mayoral election, not in this election, but the previous two, and has been a campaigner on aspects of this particular issue. And I know he's going to talk a bit about the domestic implications with some reference to policing as well. Right, thank you.
I ran for mayor of London 4 years ago, and one of the online campaigns that we did was around cannabis, around marijuana. And the title of the poster that we put online was "The Police Are Wasted on Cannabis." and that goes back to when I was the police commander back in 2001-2002 in charge of Lambeth. And picking up what Mike said about the suppression of minorities, possession of cannabis was being used by the police in Lambeth as a way of suppressing young black men in Lambeth, whereas the really difficult issues around street robbery and burglary weren't being addressed. The police were wasting their time picking on young black men in order to arrest them for small amounts of cannabis. And that's why I suggested on the front page of the London Evening Standard, without consulting my boss, that we didn't, that we should not arrest people for cannabis. And that is, as you know, that is now national policy, that the police now are able to issue a warning and confiscate the cannabis rather than arrest and prosecute people. Coming sort of up to date, the Psychoactive Substances Bill, now the Psychoactive Substances Act that Mike and Molly have talked about, sort of gives a picture of where we are politically, or at least in terms of the main political parties, as far as the drugs debate is concerned. On the 23rd of June, at the committee stage, the first real debates around the specifics of the bill, the Psychoactive Substances Bill. We, Liberal Democrats, we suggested that before the Act was implemented, this new piece of prohibition legislation was implemented, that there should be an independent, evidence-based review of all current drugs laws to see whether they were being effective or not, before we added to that pile of prohibition legislation. And we took it to a vote in the House of Lords that there should be this independent review. And 98 Liberal Democrats, with a few crossbenchers, I think, voted in favour of that approach, and 316 Labour and Tory peers voted against an independent, evidence-based review of drugs legislation. The bill, there are some very bad things about this Act, and there is one glimmer of hope in the Act. Basically, it was a commitment by both Labour and the Tories to get rid of all the head shops that sell legal highs, as was new psychoactive substances, what we call them now, because they're not legal, or at least they're not legal to sell or to manufacture. And of course, what that does, even though there is existing legislation to deal with disreputable head shops that cause, you know, where people were going consuming new psychoactive substances and then creating social problems in the area. There's loads of legislation that could have dealt with those problems anyway. They wanted to shut down all the head shops, which of course all it does is push users into the hands of street dealers, into the hands of online dealers, many of whom are overseas, where there is far less control and certainly far less comeback if things go wrong than there were with the headshots. And inevitably, we argued, the result of that will be more harm and more deaths, completely the opposite to what anybody wants, including the Labour and the Tory party. The law breaks new ground in a very, very worrying way, in that it bans everything that you consume that changes your mental state, unless it is specifically exempt. So controlled drugs are exempt because they're covered by other legislation, and would you wouldn't be surprised to hear tobacco and alcohol are amongst those things that are allowed. But it's a dangerous precedent for a government to say, you're not allowed to do something unless we say it's okay. Whereas always before, they have designated the things that you should not be doing, as opposed to a blanket ban on everything unless we say it's okay for you to do it. The one glimmer of light, as I've sort of alluded to, is the fact that it is not an offence to possess new psychoactive substances for your own use, unless you're in prison, which is a separate and more difficult area. But, of course, this creates even more confusion. I mean, already the classification system under the Misuse of Drugs Act creates confusion and derision amongst users, particularly because what class a drug is in doesn't really relate to what the harm is in many cases. But now, you've got a situation where if you have an artificial ecstasy tablet, so something that a new psychoactive substance that is manufactured to mimic the effects of MDMA, then the police, and you have one of those tabs in your pocket, the police cannot stop and search you, and the police cannot arrest you. But if you have a real ecstasy tablet, some MDMA in a tablet in your pocket, then the police can stop and search you and arrest you. What, how on earth are the police supposed to determine whether it's a real one or not? And if you say, actually, officer, the only thing I've got in my pocket is a new psychoactive substance, and the officer goes ahead and searches you and arrests you because they don't know what it is, what are the chances that you might be able to sue them? It's created a lot more confusion. So, again, as Liberal Democrats, we suggested a way of simplifying things. So we put forward an amendment which said possession of any illegal drug should not be an offence, whether it's a controlled drug or whether it's a new psychoactive substance. Now, you won't be very surprised to hear, because you would have read about it in the newspapers, but the Labour and the Tories would not support such an approach. It was, as I say, 2001-2002 when I went on an online bulletin board, as they were called in those days, called Urban 75. And one of the things that got me into a bit of trouble for using unsenior police officer-like language was help the addicts, screw the dealers, which I thought sort of summed up what our approach should be. And it's taken a bit of a while, but our party policy for the last election was that nobody should be incarcerated, nobody should be sent to prison for possession of drugs. And at our spring conference in a few weeks' time, there will be a motion that tells the government that we should have a legal and regulated market in cannabis in this country. That is going to be, if approved by party conference, going to be the Liberal Democrat policy. Now, I think there are a lot less harmful control drugs than cannabis. There are some pretty severe downsides to cannabis, particularly if you smoke it. But that's where we get bound up with the whole problem around this drugs debate. It is not scientific, objective-based reasoning. It's around what's politically possible. And because of the changes that we've heard in Canada, in certain states, in the United States, and in other countries, where cannabis has been legal, there is a sort of a political momentum around cannabis, around marijuana, that isn't present around other drugs such as such as ecstasy. And so we go with the politically possible rather than the scientifically sensible. So Norman Lamb was a health minister and in the coalition government. He is pushing, and we are pushing as a party, for drugs in the UK to be treated as a health issue and not a criminalisation issue. And we believe that the department of government that should be responsible for drugs laws and action around drugs should be the Department of Health and not the Home Office. So what we should clearly be doing, and I think the panel here agrees and probably most people in the audience agree, is that we should be absolutely focused on harm reduction. We need to base our actions on what has scientifically and objectively proved to be the best way of reducing harm, the best way of reducing deaths caused by drug taking, not tabloid headline driven political dogma, which is unfortunately what's happening with the major political parties in this country. And I'm talking about scientific objective based harm reduction. Whether that means that it gives weight to the criminalisation approach or a legalisation approach. We just absolutely have to try and get over the stigma around drug taking and the hysteria around drug taking that we see reflected in the tabloid newspapers, and take a scientific objective approach. Whatever it takes, we need to focus on reducing harm. Thank you.
Okay, so that's been a really comprehensive overview of the whole problem, which has been quite interesting, a bit longer than we normally have, but it is a complex subject, and with the conference coming up in April, there were a lot of issues to talk about. Anyhow, it's over to you now for questions or comments. Try and make them short, please. Don't make them...